Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week we return to the Acteurist Oeuvre-view, Lilli Palmer, about halfway through our journey with Lilli, and we're going to be discussing Main Street to Broadway and FEUERWERK. After that, stay tuned for Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, where we will delve into our reactions to our most recent viewing of Douglas Sirk's magnificent obsession at the TIFF Lightbox. So for Main Street to Broadway, I'm going to read you what Leonard Maltin had to say in his TV, movies, and video guide.
I'm shocked that this is in there.
FEUERWERK is not, unfortunately, but at least we do have this one. He gives it 2.5 stars out of a possible 4. Very slight story of romance, struggle, and success on the Great White Way. Chief interest is large cast of Broadway stars and cameo appearances. Rodgers and Hammerstein appear on camera and contribute a song. There's Music in You, the director, Tay Garnett. And the cast list, Tom Morton, Mary Murphy, Clinton Sundberg, Rosemary DeCamp, guest stars, Ethel Barrymore, Lionel Barrymore, Shirley Booth, Rex Harrison, Lilli Palmer, Helen Hayes, Henry Fonda, who I think was cut out of the film. We definitely didn't see him.
We did not notice Henry Fonda.
Tallulah Bankhead, Mary Martin, others. Quite a few others. So this was a very, very small cameo by Lilli and Rex.
The cameo is fun?
It is fun, and it does give us a little, very late in the marriage.
Not that late. They didn't divorce until 1957. But I guess they were starting more and more to live separate lives.
That's right. But not on camera here. Here they are experiencing connubial bliss.
For whatever reason, I guess they thought each being married to a famous person helped their careers. For whatever reason, they're still promoting the idea that they have a great marriage.
They're part of the theater scene of the time, even though Hollywood had kind of banned them.
So we get Rex Harrison. Well, they're walking down the street. They're spotted by our couple that are the center of the film's story, who are not famous actors. They're spotted as married celebrities walking down the street. They're each a sex object to the opposite sex member of the couple.
That's right, the first kiss between playwright and actress.
It's really between Rex Harrison and Lilli Palmer. They're discussing what's the best way to eat cold cuts or what's the best snack to have.
Yeah, Rex Harrison apparently was a big aficionado of combo multi-layer sandwiches, and he likens them to a concerto or a chord, I think. And her way of picking at each separate ingredient on a plate would be like playing the piano with one finger.
So the dynamic is similar to what we saw in the Four Poster in their marital movie, in that Rex Harrison is knowingly playing a kind of giddy buffoon.
Yeah.
And then she gets the better of him with her comeback. But then he turns out to comically actually have a point. And then she says how much she loves him. And they're both very funny and they have very good comic chemistry.
And they get in a car and that's last we see of them.
That's it for them. I wish they'd done more film work together.
Oh, me too.
They're going out of each other's lives soon, and sooner than that, they are already out of the lives of this podcast.
But what we're left with, I found this movie really fun to watch.
I did too. It was slaughtered by the critics, and I mean, I guess it's no masterpiece.
No, of course it's not.
It has a story of Robert E. Sherwood, and the writer is Samson Raffleson, who frequently worked with Ernst Lubitsch.
Yeah, quite a pedigree on the writing side. And James Wong Howe did the cinematography. Tay Garnett is a celebrated subterranean auteur as well.
It's hard to tell about the cinematography because the version we watched was not in good shape, but it was fun. It was pleasant. I liked the actors who played the main couple. I really liked the main actor.
Yeah, he's not someone I recognize at all.
Tommy Morton, could find out nothing about him, so he did not have any kind of spectacular career, but I thought he was great playing this proto Cassavetian New York playwright.
Clearly a proletarian, fought in the war and went to college on the GI Bill, and now he is trying to make his mark in the literary and dramatic worlds.
Yeah, Sherwood and Rathelson are definitely trying to cover all of the bases of New York theater. And the actor was from Queens. I was able to find that out.
Yeah, he's got a bit of a Richard Conte kind of feel to him. I mean, not as amazing as Richard Conte, but still.
He was really good. The whole movie is a light satire of New York theater and Broadway in particular. He was very quick-witted, kind of believably going back and forth between being a buffoon, being the butt of the joke, and being in on the joke and being witty.
The actress who gets sort of romantically involved with him against her will through most of the running time of the film is Mary Murphy. She was awesome in this movie. She's like a Donna Reed type.
Also awesome, this was like a great love triangle. Also awesome was radio TV humorist Herb Schreiner.
Yeah, I was really pleased to actually see him because I've heard of him because of my interest in old time radio. I know the name Herb Schreiner, and I knew he was some kind of hayseed comic, you know, like a Will Rogers type, but I've never seen him or heard him actually.
No, he was very charismatic. It was like having Will Rogers play the Ralph Bellamy role.
Yeah, I loved him. I would have been happy if he had gotten the girl too.
Of course, when he first makes his appearance, you can't help but think, oh, David Lynch has entered the movie. And before long, there's a hardware reference to Blue Velvet.
Yeah, I mean, he runs a hardware store and he displays his wrenches on Blue Velvet. I do think David Lynch saw this movie.
David Lynch's brain contains all of classic Hollywood cinema. That's what we're discovering. I think I've said this exactly these words before, but Henry James anticipates all of classical Hollywood cinema, and then David Lynch just took it all in and filtered it through his personal idiosyncrasy, and his oeuvre came out of that.
It could be.
You know what I like to do with a monkey wrench? Take some Blue Velvet and display it in the window against the Blue Velvet. Anyway, what's the story that we get here between these two? Oh, actually, we should talk about the production first. Why was this weird movie made? Well, TCM tells us, according to news items, the film was produced as a fundraising vehicle to benefit the Council of the Living Theater, a non-profit organization founded by a small group of New York actors to promote and fund live theater. 25% of the film's profits would be donated to the organization, which would use the money to increase memberships in roadshow cities and to further interest in the legit theater. In addition, writer Robert E. Sherwood donated his entire $50,000, God, imagine that, in 1953.
It's a lot of money.
Story fee to the council. Cinnamon Productions Incorporated, which produced Main Street to Broadway, was made up of film exhibitors and headed by Fred Schwartz and M.A. Lightman, both of whom were presidents of regional chains of movie houses, and they partnered with MGM.
For distribution. You get the sense that it's a public relations outreach effort.
Even moviegoers.
Of course.
That there's interest in live theater.
Helen Hayes introduces the film and occasionally returns as a very sporadic narrator.
Big role for Tallulah Bankhead as herself.
She's got just the right touch of self-deprecation going on here.
Yeah, so she does have a good comic touch. Ethel and Lionel Barrymore have a scene. This is Lionel's last film.
He died this year.
Yeah, he's looking a little rickety. Ethel gets more to do.
I think she died the next year, but she looks very healthy in this movie.
Cornel Wilde shows up early on, delivering a ridiculous monologue in a ridiculous accent, so he's having some fun.
Oh, I thought that was amazing. Yeah, so that's the play, the initial play that our protagonist has written. It's about a man, some kind of bindle stiff with an Irish brogue on a train.
Casey, who keeps referring to himself in the third person.
He's got this beautiful young woman who's been tagging along after him, maybe like, you know, Veronica Lake in Sullivan's Travels, and he throws her off the train, and this is his great symbolic victory, winning back his freedom.
Well, as he says to the audience, now you're free, Casey, free. This is what freedom is. And then it's curtain.
Yeah.
The thing is, I don't know if it serves the interests of live theater that the way Rathelson has written this, his final play doesn't seem any better. The one that makes it to Broadway with Tallulah Bankhead doesn't seem any better than this initial play.
Well, it's more audacious, I would say. Ends with a game of Russian roulette with poison canapes.
I have to say, even though it's the oldest trick in the book, the coup de théâtre of whoever has partnered with her to commit these crimes.
Yeah, Clinton Sundberg.
Yeah. when he's laughing and laughing and laughing and he keeps laughing, it actually worked on me. Yeah. It actually worked on me that I didn't know why he was laughing. I thought it was just a joke on how bad the writing was. But then you realize, no, it's a plot twist. It was great.
Yeah, there's a lot going on in the movie. The meet cute of the film between our star-crossed lovers occurs during the scene with Cornell Wilde, because she is the ingenue who was thrown off the train.
She's creating problems. The playwright is complaining about her because she doesn't seem to be into her part enough.
No, and we find out that she isn't. She thinks it's a horrible, stupid play.
She thinks it's a chauvinist play, yes.
It is. Yeah. And apparently her outburst helps to convince Cornell Wilde that he doesn't want any part of it. Yeah, he's miffed.
And then they get some very cute banter when Tom Morton goes after her to complain and has lots of lines about how he's the king of self-pity. They really have a great back and forth there. And, you know, he's very self-aware. At this point in the movie, before he gets obsessed with writing his new play, he's quite self-aware. And he's kind of aware that he's self-aware.
And she basically has decided that's it. This is my last ingenue audition. I'm going back to Indiana and get married and have a family. She has invented a fiancé named Frank.
Yeah, she wants to duck out of this burgeoning relationship with this penniless, self-centered, cranky playwright.
Everything does turn on Lilli Palmer and Rex Harrison walking by at just the right moment to inspire them to kiss.
Yeah, let's hope that this isn't what their future is going to be like, those two.
I hope not. But yeah, that kiss leaves the door open for another encounter the next day, and things just snowball, and all of a sudden, he's accompanying her back to Indiana to meet her family, and he gets the idea that he can draw inspiration from Main Street and bring it to Broadway. And it's all bound up with a scheme engineered by Agnes Moorehead to devise an all-American homemaker play and role for Tallulah Bankhead, who's looking for a change of pace. It is all very funny. It's interesting that Agnes Moorehead is playing a character and not herself. Almost every other famous person is playing themselves.
That was odd.
But, you know, she's the consummate actress, so she went for that. She was very funny as the agent. Tallulah, she just keeps saying, like, so when do I kill someone? Or who do I want to kill? Or who's going to kill me? You know, none of that. You're just going to be wearing calico and knitting.
Because now he has this silly idea. His great play is going to be about little small town Midwestern people.
The wholesomeness thereof.
And fatherhood and parenthood, just like Mary Murphy's been complaining about. He's swinging in the opposite direction.
Yeah, and so she brings him to this small town. I mean, it might as well be David Lynchville, USA, except there are no severed ears.
Indiana.
He meets Mary Murphy's parents.
Her father's a real estate agent.
Clinton Sundberg, Rosemary DeCamp, last seen on this podcast as the deadly antagonist, the psychotherapist of Zachary Scott.
I think her best moment is in the car when they bust Mary Murphy for not really having a fiancé. And when she says, oh, an imaginary fiancé, dear? Is that what it is?
That was pretty cute. They live up to the billing. They are paragons of parenthood. They're very nice. They welcome him into their home. He's writing and writing and writing. He gets along well with them, but everything he writes, he throws away.
Well, he starts trying to imagine Tallulah Bankhead with her southern accent being Rosemary DeCamp.
Doesn't work.
It's not working.
No.
And he realizes, of course, you know, he's facing the problem that he doesn't actually know anything about these people. I thought the resolution was going to be he would somehow find a way to write about the little people anyway, but it's not that at all.
No.
It turns out that, and it's not like he's writing about his own life either, he just switches from imitating one kind of play to imitating a different kind of play. His imagination is purely literary. He's getting all his ideas from other plays.
But the way the movie works actual Main Street values into the movie is via Herb Schreiner, who, as you were saying, is just as good as advertised as well. He's almost like an Agent Cooper type.
He's quirky as fuck.
This is one of the most Lynchian characters I've seen in an old movie. He arrives right at the opportune moment because the playwright has freaked out and decided he can't create anything in Indiana and he has to run away back to New York to his garret to complete the composition. They leave things in a kind of unsettled state. He's already proposed. Like, they're supposed to get married, but now that all of that's on hold.
Well, because all he really cares about is his play.
So that's not very flattering. And then this very nice man drives up and he's lost in the town and he's talking about expanding his hardware empire to South Terre Haute, Indiana. And he insinuates himself into the family. This family just keeps taking on son surrogates who might marry their daughter.
His name is Frank.
Yes. Works out very nicely
that
way.
Which also has a blue velvet resonance.
Well, yeah, except he's not like the blue velvet Frank.
No.
Why are there people like Frank? In this case, you know, why aren't there more people like Frank? And after that, we're switching back and forth between life in South Terre Haute, where everything's kind of in stasis as they await news of the play.
And she does really like Herb Shriner.
She does.
She's not entirely sure who she's in love with here. As she says, that bluntly to Tom Morton, "I hope it's not you."
Yep.
Now, we know it is him, mainly because as fabulous as Herb Shriner is, he is not very sexual.
No.
When he first gets to South Terre Haute, they have a very sexy kissing scene. It was a surprising bit of eroticism in this film.
You're talking about the playwright.
Well, yeah, the playwright. And
yeah, not Herb Shriner.
No. Tom and Mary.
Yeah. They have really good chemistry on a couple of occasions that is highlighted by the film.
Yeah, and then Herb Shriner's not getting any of that.
He does sit on the porch with her, but that's about it.
Probably his finest moment is when he is explaining to her what his letter would be like if he was in Tom Morton's position, setting up a new hardware business. No matter how important that new store was, she would still be more important to him.
But he uses business-like Main Street metaphors.
Yes.
So this letter from your guy in New York sounds like he's writing to a supplier.
Yeah, to a wholesale supplier instead of a valued customer.
That's right.
And I knew, of course, as someone who works in retail at the buying end, I knew exactly what he was talking about. As Tom Morton's struggling to write this new play idea that he's come up with, this very Tallulah Bankhead-esque multiple murder story. It's not really a mystery.
Well, it's hard to really understand what's going on in it, but it does end in a crescendo of death and violence and laughter.
So he's living in his little tenement apartment, and so he gets a lot of interplay now with Gertrude Berg.
Yeah, she was great.
So Gertrude Berg, according to her Wikipedia, was an American actress, screenwriter, and producer, a pioneer of classic radio. She was one of the first women to create, write, produce, and star in a long-running hit when she premiered her serial comedy, The Rise of the Goldbergs. Weren't we just seeing an interview recently with Abraham Polonsky? Did he name her?
Yeah.
Okay, saying that she got him his start, convinced him he should be a playwright and not a future lawyer.
That's right.
Yeah, be a writer.
No, that's an immensely influential radio show. Very important in the history of American media. I've actually never heard an episode, but there are some out there. I'll probably give it a listen. I know that there are some stereotyping problems in it that are just inevitable at the time. Yeah, it's something I've meant to explore just to see what it's like, and you can't argue with her success anyway.
So she's playing a Yiddish landlady, I guess.
Yeah.
And she is trying to steer him in the direction of not trashing this relationship. She's being very motherly.
Wants him to focus on both things. She's cheering him on in his efforts to complete this play. She likes it a lot, but she's like, you know, keep writing to this girl too. She sounds good.
Yeah, and it's not just that he's egocentric. He's clearly emotionally immature and afraid.
Well, maybe his growth was stunted when he was forced to go fight in the army for several years.
Right, that's the scene with Ethel Barrymore where they make a point of talking about his war service. Don't run away from the rewriting of this play, but it turns out he doesn't have to because the movie makes the joke about the playwright who makes the huge gesture. Also seen in Imitation of Life, where the playwright makes the huge gesture of destroying all of their copies, but then it turns out they still have another copy.
All of that happens because he completes this labor of love. He calls Mary in Terre Haute. He announces that they can now get married. Everything's good. Sends the play off to Agnes Moorhead, the agent, so that Tallulah Bankhead can read it over. This is the reverse of what they asked for. Nobody wants it.
Are we to believe, by Agnes Moorhead's later reaction, though, that it's her secret plan to somehow for this all to come about so that Tallulah Bankhead decides to do this play anyway?
No, I don't think so. I just think she's smiling because, well, this is going to go my way after all. She seems genuinely pissed at him.
She does.
For doing that. I mean, he disappeared. He took her advance, ran off to Indiana, didn't contact her at all until several months later when he gives her this play, which is full of murder and death. The whole idea was don't do that.
I've got to say that that as someone who briefly worked in theater, this all seems very plausible. Other than the fact that where I was working, you weren't going to be running across movie stars that might make you a famous playwright at every point.
Fate takes a hand here, because as he prepares to jettison his magnum opus, all the five copies wrapped up in glossy paper, throws them in the river, he gets arrested because the police aren't exactly sure what he was doing. Was he dropping a body in there or what? This reaches Faye Emerson. Right? We also last saw her in Danger Signal, the movie where Rosemary DeCamp played the psychiatrist. So Faye Emerson, by 1953, she had sort of a this is my beat New York kind of thing. Poignant and snappy anecdotes. And this catches everyone's ear. Everyone's listening. So Mary over in Terre Haute hears it and decides she has to rush to New York to help him. So do the Barrymores and Louis Calhern. They decide that this is worth investigating. So they go and bail this guy out. They get him out of jail and vouch for him.
It's like a variation of Ethel Barrymore's Portrait of Jenny character.
The suffering artist, you must do something to alleviate his pain here. And they tell him, we're going to give this script to John Van Druten.
There's also some stuff where Mary Martin sings and we see Rodgers and Hammerstein. Nothing to do with the plot.
No, but it was part of the efforts to raise funds. I wonder what Henry Fonda was doing. Guess we'll never know.
According to the TCM notes, there were much more elaborate plans for this movie at various points, including many different stars and Technicolor and musical numbers and so on and so forth.
Yes, so many actors are glimpsed at least for a second or two. We saw Jesse Royce Landis. We saw Eli from Peyton Place, Arthur Shields.
There's, of course, also a cameo by Leo DeRocher.
Yeah, that was great. I'm still kind of a novice with Tallulah Bankhead, but must have been something that was part of her public persona, that she was obsessed with the New York Giants.
Yes.
And so she stops everything in the middle of the day to listen to the end of the ball game between the Giants and the Brooklyn Dodgers. She takes issue with decision to replace the starting pitcher in a confrontation with Duke Snyder at the plate.
And she turns out to be right, but he's pissed off anyway.
And his son is on the bench with him.
His little son.
Leo DeRocher is a really interesting personality. His nickname was Leo the Lip. He was a good fielding shortstop who didn't really hit very well in the 30s with the Gashouse Gang Cardinals, who were a bunch of miscreants who were very good.
Oh my god, we've triggered Dave's baseball knowledge.
He became a quite renowned manager, but, you know, very pugnacious. He was thrown out of so many games, always on the verge of getting into fights. And he married Lorraine Day, who was a movie star in the 40s, and they became a radio item. They had like a daily show, I think.
Were they being pugnacious with each other? Because he certainly is here with Tallulah Bankhead.
It's another one where I've never actually listened to it, but there are some episodes.
Anyway, his son asks, was that Mom?
No, this was not Mom. And they just roped in so many different people from various walks of life in New York to celebrate the theater.
Yeah, this movie was an absolute flop, though. So our story wraps up with Mary Murphy, her character basically decides she doesn't know who she loves or what she wants to do with her life. She knows she's going to be miserable if she marries this playwright, but she might love him anyway. For now, she's just in it to see the play through. So she's been caught by the theater.
And so she becomes instrumental in various roles behind the scenes, getting the production together. She's assisting Tallulah Bankhead. She's offering her criticisms on the script. Turns out the play is not going to do all that well. It might run for 3 weeks just because Tallulah Bankhead is in it.
Because of the underwhelmed critic reaction, so much like the movie itself.
Brooks Atkinson is in the movie. There's several prominent critics up here as sour-faced lookers-on. I guess they didn't mind satirizing themselves either. So it's not a story of triumph on Broadway, really, but their relationship emerges stronger from it.
Well, yeah, Tallulah Bankhead tells him, you're gonna have a lot of flops, so just soldier on. I've had to do it. No one's had more flops than I have.
It's really interesting, though, because she says, well, you know, grab that girl as your crutch to lean on. And that's basically what he does.
Well, he tries to give her up to Herb Shriner, but she won't go because she's caught up in the world of theater now, and she can make her contribution by looking after this jerk and editing his plays and typing them, whatever.
It'd be nice if she got to do something creative herself in the theater.
Well, she doesn't seem to be interested other than being his sounding board, doing the wife bit. So basically, basically what she said she was going to end up doing is pretty much what she's going to end up doing, complained about originally. I'm going to have to support us and be a housewife and
make food.
Type your manuscripts and criticize your manuscripts and etc.
Yeah, not exactly a good model for a relationship from our perspective, but that's how the movie decides to end things, and Herb Schreiner gets the last word as he drives out of the picture, talking about his lack of success with women. He kind of steals the picture.
Yeah, kind of.
So.
And I mean, I really liked Tom Morton too.
But... yeah. No, everyone was good. Glad we saw it, but it doesn't tell us much about the career of Lilli Palmer.
Yeah, other than the fact that obviously the movie is nodding to her stage career.
Yeah, she and Rex were names and images to conjure with. When you're talking about the theater world of the early 1950s in America, gotta have Rex and Lilli, apparently. Let's turn our attention to FEUERWERK, Fireworks, a West German film. This is our first time watching Lilli Palmer give a performance in her native language.
True. So this was based on the 1950 stage musical Das Feuerwerk, partly written by Eric Schorell, who, well, I mean, he was an operetta writer. The song Oh Mein Papa, which everybody knows, did originate with that show. And Lilli Palmer's version of it was a big hit. And this movie was a big hit, and it launched her on a successful film career in Germany.
Once she left Germany and went to Paris, for about a year or two, I think, what she was doing was a cabaret act, singing with her sister.
Yeah, and she very much downplayed her ability, but in fact, her voice is lovely.
Yeah, she does a very good job with these songs. Maybe they're keyed perfectly to her, and I'm sure she didn't have, like, opera star range or anything, but yeah, she's very good.
Well, she's not reduced to Rex Harrison talk singing.
No, not at all.
This was very enjoyable, and I loved Lilli Palmer in it, and she's the name above the title, and I loved Romy Schneider in it. Do we have a Romy Schneider spotlight?
No, but we will see her again with Lilli Palmer in the remake of Mädchen in Uniform.
Yeah, I mean, you can see how she's a star. She's completely radiant. Lilli Palmer is 40 in this, and I was starting to feel over the hill at 40, but she looks fantastic. This is our first time seeing her in Technicolor. It's amazing.
Yeah, well, she just looks better and better as time goes by, it seems.
She seems to be getting better looking, yes. So what's going on in this movie, Dave?
We don't meet Lilli for quite a while, because we're in this hamlet. I guess it's in Bavaria?
Yeah, the movie was made by Bavaria Studios in Munich. There was also location work in Switzerland. Her father, Romy Schneider's father, is a wealthy manufacturer of garden gnomes.
Very important aspect of the story. It's his 50th birthday. That's the occasion that is being celebrated at the beginning of this film.
She has some aspirations for being a dancer. She takes lessons. She's going to give a performance at this birthday.
She has a beau, and he is also part of the gardening world, but a very different side of it. He's more interested in the vegetation, and he's actually written a hit piece on garden gnomes.
Well, yeah, so there's competing aesthetics here, and he's anti-kitsch, but when we actually see his... I mean, this whole thing is a Bavarian...
chocolate box.
Yeah, this whole thing is a Bavarian chocolate box. It's a Bavarian operetta, so the whole thing looks like kitsch to us.
Vibrant Technicolor.
And we see his miniature of their future home, and what they're going to turn it into. And then little miniature versions of themselves do a song in the house and yard.
Yeah, I really like the special effects there as the house grows.
And grows into an aesthetic monstrosity. I was very unsure about this movie for the first third, but once the circus comes to town and Lilli Palmer arrives, it just gets better and better.
The stage is set. You've got this conservative German family.
It's almost a vibe of Fanny and Alexander without the angst.
Well, I was going to say exactly that. This celebration at times does feel like it anticipates some scenes from Fanny and Alexander, the Christmas celebrations.
But there is angst. I mean, there's not Bergman levels of angst, but there's angst.
There's a lot of angst, yeah, because everyone is kind of repressing themselves to one extent or another, except for, you know, the head villain policing everyone's activities, and especially her husband, she keeps telling him he has a cough.
The women are policing the men, but she's
policing the other women.
She's policing everyone and extra policing her husband.
Yeah, she's the one that doesn't have a husband at the end.
Yes.
The fireworks of the title Frenzel, the little brother of Romy Schneider, is really into fireworks. He's got a huge kit that he's planning to set off, but he hides it in the fireplace, and at a certain point they get exploded. I don't know if there's enough fireworks in this movie for it to be called fireworks.
Well, maybe it's a metaphor, Dave.
But maybe they could have called it Oh Mein Papa or Circus or something.
Yeah, that would have been better. Circus.
Anyway, there are fireworks of the emotional kind when the circus arrives, and it is owned and operated by the black sheep of the family, Sasha. Alexander. But Sasha is what everyone calls him.
And he is married to Lilli Palmer.
He's got a roving eye, and when we meet him, he's helping all of the circus chorus girls off the truck.
Yeah, and it seems to make no sense at all, because Lilli Palmer does not look 40. Well, he seems like he's part of a middle-aged couple, but she does not.
Well, yeah, but that's what they're talking about. You know, he's a little bit past it, and trying to feel his way back to his wild oats. I think the movie is just saying, you know, obviously Lilli Palmer is the best option anyone ever has, but he's grown numb to that to some extent.
Right, and it's about his own vanity and midlife crisis, as they discuss.
So all the other brothers, there are some tense moments.
The circus nonsense, or the magician nonsense, also occurs in Bergman.
It does, yeah.
When he arrives with Lilli Palmer and explains that he is the circus that has come to town.
Well, he says, I'm the director, and they're like, oh great, a bank director? They go through everything you can be a director of, and then he finally says, no, I'm the circus director.
Well, someone points that out. Isn't it the little boy who guesses?
Yeah.
Or he's seen him. He did throw fireworks at his horse.
That's right.
As the parade of the circus was going through the town. And of course, Lilli Palmer is dressed in a very shocking, sexual, bohemian way, and she is radiant, and all of the men are fawning over her. It's like Barbara Stanwyck in The Lady Eve. Meanwhile, Sasha starts up a very disturbing flirtation with his young niece, who is actually blood related to him.
I guess to give him the benefit of the doubt, he doesn't seem to even quite realize what he's doing.
But the movie, the script realizes it.
Yeah. And she takes all the wrong hints. I mean, she wants to run off with the circus.
Sure, but there is a little bit of a Charlie and Charlie Shadow of a Doubt vibes coming from her.
Yeah, yeah, very much so.
Well, I mean, that's the same thing. In Shadow of a Doubt, young Charlie thinks of her Uncle Charlie as some glamorous person that she might become and escape this small town, right?
Yeah, she doesn't want to have sex with him, but she's totally in love with him in a way.
Yeah, she's infatuated with him.
And yeah, this leaves her gardening boyfriend out in the cold. He starts stewing.
Lilli Palmer's big number comes when she's been monopolizing these men and, you know, making them feel alive for the first time in decades. The women come over, led by the evil ringleader, questioning her about her pedigree, right? Where does she come from? What's her family like? And of course, she responds very ironically. The keynote of Palmer's performance here. We were talking about this a little bit too in the four poster, and it seems to be the culminating result of dealing with the Nazis and then living with Rex Harrison, that she has this irony and self-possession that is so tremendous that it's almost like dissociation. This is how she's acting like in this scene. And so the women come over and interrogate her, and she reveals in this way that's setting them up to look like fools that she is the daughter of a clown.
Yeah, she says he was a king, but that translates as he was, you know, the greatest of clowns, the handsomest of clowns. And that's what the song is about. This is a movie. Now, people who have listened to our back catalog may know that, especially at the beginning, in the first 20 or 30 episodes, we had many incidents of emasculated clowns. This is the opposite of that. This is the triumph of the clown.
Well, this is what's so fascinating about Palmer's character, because she is this great beauty, but she is inhabited by the spirit of the clown, who is the spirit of the circus and the spirit of art, right?
Yeah, she delivers this wonderful tribute to her father. And in the act itself, in the circus, the centerpiece there is her song about her pony.
Yeah.
And she has, you know, a dance and a kind of romantic duet with two guys who are dressed as a horse.
It's a pantomime horse.
So she's very comfortable doing these glamorous things in ridiculous anti-glamorous contexts.
And so she delivers this song, and she gets everyone involved in it. Singles out Gustav, the most henpecked of the husbands.
The one who's always being told he has a cough.
She says that you looked like my father. And of course, he's not handsome at all, but that's what she says. You look like my father, something about your eyes, right?
He looks like George C. Scott, actually, that actor. It was kind of weird.
And when she, the close-up on her face when she's singing about her father, say like frozen mania.
Another level of being.
Yep, yeah, just transcendent, it is. And she's singing about his eyes shining like diamonds, or whatever the lyric is, right?
Well, she got the eyes, definitely.
And everyone joins in, and then that's a song that climaxes with the fireworks, right?
Because some of the clowns are doing, like, fire-eating acts and stuff like that. Fascist aunt won't have any truck with that. She grabs the incendiary device off him and throws it in the fireplace and explodes this whole kit of fireworks that had been hidden there long ago by a little Franzel.
So in terms of the pedigree of this movie, the operetta writer, the writer of the stage musical, was Jewish and was obviously hounded out of Nazi Germany. There's a little bit of interesting stuff on him on his extensive Wikipedia page. So he escaped to America, did have a successful Broadway production of something called White Horse Inn, which sounds absolutely insane, made into a German movie in 1952. I kind of want to see it now, although it did star an operetta star who was a very enthusiastic Nazi.
Wow.
During the war? But here's what I found interesting. So after the success of White Horse Inn on Broadway, Chorel adapted Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream as a jazz operetta and presented it as Swinging the Dream on Broadway at the Center Theater in 1939.
Oh, I know about this. I've seen New York Times articles on it from the period.
It was a daring and innovative production because Chorel used only black actors and singers, including Louis Armstrong, Count Basie, Maxine Sullivan, Mums Mabley, Dorothy Dandridge, and Butterfly McQueen, W.C. Handy, Fats Waller, Count Basie, many other black jazz songwriters contributed music to it. Benny Goodman was in it as well, but the production closed after only 13 performances.
Yeah, I know.
That's just, oh, that's painful. Probably due to racism, and also the war had just started.
Well, it hadn't started in America.
No, that's true. Well, that's the explanations in order being offered by Wikipedia.
Okay, no, I think it's probably just racism.
Just racism. The critics were also racist, apparently.
No doubt.
Fascinating. This guy was something of an innovator.
I didn't know what we were going to get with this one, but I was very impressed. It's a great role for Lilli Palmer.
So after this number, well, as you said, we also get more of the actual circus numbers. We get her pantomime horse pony number.
Her pony Johnny.
The aunt decides that she's going to take Romy Schneider in hand. The girl's going to live with her and learn some discipline.
Yeah, and unfortunately, her mother doesn't really stand up for her at that point. You can see she's got some misgivings, and later she voices them, but here she just apparently is going to consign her daughter to this hell, and Romy Schneider is like, well, my uncle is definitely cooler than this fate that they're planning for me, so I'm going to run off with the circus, and she proceeds to attempt to do so.
This incest angle adds more discomfort even than you normally would have with a middle-aged man and a girl who must be in her early 20s and looks and acts considerably younger. I wonder how old Romy Schneider actually is in this.
She was 16.
Holy crap! Yeah, so it's like disturbing on so many levels. That adds a bit of Lynchian creepiness to it. And we get even more Lynchian creepiness when she has her circus dream.
Yeah.
Her wild circus dream where she's lying in his very kitschy trailer where we're led to understand he often takes young girls. Maybe some of the women who work for him, maybe also just girls he finds in the towns they pass through.
It's always a good opportunity when the circus comes to town.
But in this case, luckily, as we've said, he isn't actually interested in incest.
He just makes sure she lies down and tries to settle her nerves after she's been threatened with exile to the evil aunts.
But there's this leopard skin rug or whatever lying over the back of the couch that she sleeps on, and there's some oddly angled shots of her sweaty, dreaming face and this darling leopard face over her, right? And then we get this circus nightmare where she's trying to choose between the two men. But then her unconscious causes her to realize that her real hero is the gardener.
And he does rush in to save her from death at the hands of some big cats.
So really, this has all been about, it hasn't been about love. It's been about her, I don't know, her artistic vocation and how it's being stifled by her family and her society. society.
Yeah.
And like I said, for Lilli Palmer, who barely says in the word in the movie that doesn't start with "my father says," is being inhabited by this male clown spirit the entire time, who is the spirit of art and liberation, right?
The plot mechanisms that are initiated by this attempt to escape. You've got the fiance who's enraged and terrified that he's going to lose her, and he infects Lilli Palmer with his agony, and she decides enough is enough. He's going to start trying to sleep with his own niece.
On their anniversary, which he's forgotten. So that's all the final straw.
She prepares to leave. Even though the Spontini brothers, who are like, you know, talent scouts, I guess, are on their way, or they're big impresarios, if they see the circus and they like it, they're going to have a very lucrative engagement touring the British Isles. And she doesn't care. She's leaving. This would throw a wrench in their chances to make good on the international stage.
That pony number is important.
It's essential. She runs into the Spontini brothers during her flight. She winds up coming back after throwing a real scare into Sasha and the whole circus. And he realizes that he's really lost without her, not only as a circus director, but as a husband.
And what he has to do to make it up to her is to acknowledge that he is in fact her pony.
That's right.
So he has to be a buffoon, and he has to acknowledge that he is the one who, and it's kind of actually very moving, that he is the one who laughs and cries with her.
So in some of those earlier movies that we talked about in 2019, a man had to be humbled by being a clown. Here, you're humbled by being a pony.
And but you're also elevated by being the pony.
Yeah, but you're especially exalted by being a clown, as Uncle Gustav is.
Oh, I see what you mean, yeah.
The clown is...
But the pony is important.
The pony is very important, a double-edged symbol there.
And he is especially wild pony. He's initially...
Well, he's too big for the costume.
Well, he throws everything off. First of all, it's delayed because the real pony is drunk.
They have to vamp, and she's like, is my pony sick in there? Did I give him too many sugar cubes?
And then with this new pony, they have to improvise a new act. And he is a wild and a manic pony, and she has to discipline him. What's interesting is that what they improv is that he has to forgive her rather than the other way around because she ran off.
Yeah, it really does come to a perfect conclusion. As much as these things can happen, it didn't happen between Lilli Palmer and Rex Harrison, but maybe the marriage we see in this movie will get back on track properly. Well,
maybe he really did just have a midlife crisis. It's hard to know. It's a movie that, like so many Hollywood movies that we've seen from the classical era, it's hard to know if he's really been seducing all of these women or...
Or just thinking about it or gesturing toward it without following up.
Yeah, we don't know.
For everyone's sake, hopefully that's all it was. And
Or that it's over anyway.
Yeah. Romy Schneider gets back together with her fiancé. The family is much more solidly behind everyone.
And we almost forgot the movie's best note of all at the end.
Oh, Gustav.
Gustav.
Well, we've discussed him becoming a clown.
Yeah, but he is discovered at this moment of grace and forgiveness, right? He's discovered because we knew he ran away, but this is when we find out that he has become a clown.
An aerialist clown, which is quite something for a man of his increasing years.
Who has never done it before,
no,
yes.
No, but he finds it within him to work that trapeze like nobody's business as a clown. And he joins the circus.
So he does what Romy Schneider wanted to do. For him, it works.
Yeah, he's the one who really needed it.
Well, yeah, he's been very, very repressed. And
that marriage is over, definitely.
And oppressed. Yeah, she's not going to miss him.
No, I don't think so. She'll just boss her sisters around and their husbands. And that is our FEUERWERK.
Yeah, it was great.
You definitely sound like you're sold on Lilli Palmer as an actor.
Yeah, I mean, obviously she doesn't have the careers of some of the actors we've looked at who either, you know, like Daniel Day-Lewis or Jennifer Jones have a very limited, hand-picked filmography, or ones whose image were crafted by the Hollywood studios. She doesn't have either of those things, but it does seem like in her stage years, some kind of persona emerged. Some kind of particular, well, like I said, basing her performances around irony and feeling free to be very stylized. Also having a great, that we even see in the cameo in Main Street to Broadway, a great precision of language. I mean, some of the Hollywood actors who are better at comedy, like Barbara Stanwyck, can do that too. But I always admire that. The quickness of the delivery of complicated comic lines with precision and enunciation. I always admire that.
Yeah, and she can do it in three languages.
Carol Lombard, also. Lubitsch could get that out of people.
Yeah, it's too bad she never worked with Lubitsch. I bet that would have been good.
Yeah.
Lilli Palmer, I think at the beginning you were skeptical.
Of her as a performer? Well, we started very early before she'd learned how to do anything.
You know, before we even started with her, you were like, who is this you're throwing at me here?
Well, as I said, it had more to do with the size of her filmography and doing every single film.
And we'll see. There may still be diminishing returns as we get into some of those spy thrillers that she was in the 60s, but I think we've got a good run of movies coming up, some of which I have seen, but I'm happy that movies that I hadn't seen, like Feuerwerk, are making my case for me as well.
Mm-hmm.
Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, Elise. We saw Magnificent Obsession, based on Lloyd C. Douglas's wonderful inspirational novel. We don't have this one on the schedule yet, although I am thinking by about 2040... I'm going to do a Magnificent Obsessions episode where we will read the novel and watch both movies.
That'd be great.
We do have the Stahl movie on the schedule within a couple of years as a Universal studio film of 1935. But then after 14 years pass, we'll be able to discuss that one again. Devote a little time here to the Sirk movie.
So watching this movie made me feel like one of the benefits of getting old is seeing movies over and over again over the course of decades and them becoming new experiences for you, because it's more frequent to do that, even though we talked about how we don't watch movies obsessively over and over the way we did when we were younger.
We seize the occasion when they show at TIFF or other repertory cinemas.
But it's more frequent to do that than to reread a book just because of time, right?
Well, that's true.
Well, this is one where, because I did watch it often when I was younger, I've built up that knowledge of it, right? I've probably watch it almost as much as all of the other big Sirks. So the Technicolor, Imitation of Life, Written on the Wind, All That Heaven Allows, the big four, right? But it has never been, in contrast to the others, I've never really been able to appreciate it. It's never been an emotional film for me because it is so insane and over the top. Well, so are they all. But this one in its plot is really crazy. It's a really crazy soap opera. But I benefited from having seen it over and over again and having all of this knowledge of it stored in my synapses. It was a big emotional experience for me. A big emotional experience. I just thought it was beautiful.
Me too.
It was a beautiful movie. I was like low-key misty eyes through the whole thing. It's so wonderfully written. Like, all of these Sirk movies, when I'm watching them, the big four, make me think that, as I said when we did Imitation of Life, that I'm watching the greatest screenplay of all time. And it can't be that. It has to be somehow the way Sirk is directing these screenplays. But, I mean, they are also good screenplays. Maybe it's a movie for your older age. Jane Wyman is older in it. Not as old as I am, though. And maybe my recent health scare helped open it up for me.
Sure, you've been through some hospital time.
Yeah, nothing like what she goes through in this movie. Maybe my greater openness to mysticism as I age has something to do with it, too. I don't know, but it all came together for me, and I just loved it. I just loved it in every way.
Well, I've always loved it. Love the book. I love the Stahl movie, too. Each of them are discrete entities. There have been quite a lot of changes made, even based on the adaptation. There are characters added in this one that are not in the Stahl version, characters subtracted that are not in the, like, in the 35 film, Robert Taylor has a sidekick, Charles Butterworth, who's with him all the time. You can't really even imagine that in the Sirk movie, because Rock Hudson has to be kind of alone, wrestling with himself all the time.
Yep.
In this movie. And I think it really works well.
Well, alone other than Otto Kruger, who is a completely different kind of Lynchian presence than Herb Schreiner.
Well, yes, but that character is in every iteration. I mean, that's Lloyd Douglas's mouthpiece for this Christian pantheism that he preaches. It's Ralph Morgan in the 1935 film. But one real key to the movie for me, I do think, is Barbara Rush as the stepdaughter of Jane Wyman. She's there kind of to register things for us, right?
Well, she and Agnes Moorehead together are doing heroine chorus/sidekick roles.
Well, they are, but, you know, she's got a much more antagonistic relationship to Rock Hudson, and when she finally falls in love with the idea of him being in love with Jane Wyman, I mean, that's when we're kind of freed to exult in it as well.
Yeah, the love story completely believed it in all of its insanity this time, and ages ago, when I first started watching the movie, George Toles called my attention to how much of the movie is about Jane Wyman's character's emotional repression.
Mm-hmm.
And that becomes... What's so interesting about the movie is that Rock Hudson and Jane Wyman are such low-key performers, right? Because the plot is so wild and crazy and soap opera full of coincidences and illnesses and accidents, you would think that you'd want actors to go big. Big like Dorothy Malone in Written on the Wind. But no, they don't go big. They go in. That becomes the tonal focal point of the movie, which is one of the modes of soap opera that Robert Warshaw talks about, morbidity and depression, right? And in this movie, it's Wyman's repression. Like, her performance, her character is so believably, like, she is the thing as much as Otto Kruger that produces this transformation in Rock Hudson. That is because she is so believably, utterly believably sweet. And like Otto Kruger says, she doesn't even need the Christian pantheism because she is already perfect. She's already just such a naturally sweet, loving, kind person. And Wyman convinces you of this, but also the movie more and more begins to explore, as worse and worse things happen to her, how much of that is a result of suppressing and putting aside her own feelings.
Right, and she, as wonderful as she is, she ultimately does succumb to depression. When
yes.
She is told that there's nothing they can do when they're in Switzerland, she's at a really low ebb. And when Rock Hudson shows up as his Robbie persona, I mean, it is a soaring moment of cinema when she realizes that he's there for her to help her.
Oh, yeah. And like the sexual vibes are real.
Yeah.
And then they have to go burn the witch. Yeah. George loved that symbolism. The witch of sexual repression. But then she has more... worst depression to go through, where she runs from the relationship. She's afraid of it. And I would be too, because it has emerged in a very crazy way. But then the ending, right? Which perfectly encapsulates that Warshaw idea of soap opera and the tone that Sirk has found in this movie. Can I get excited tomorrow?
You can.
Yeah, but we're never going to see tomorrow. So she's got to keep repressing this emotion, keep dampening it down, right?
When tomorrow comes...
Tomorrow, and these tears, these little tears traveling down your cheeks. Tomorrow.
I'm happy that they're going to have it, even if we didn't get to see it. Everyone's great in the movie. Just another masterful performance by Rock Hudson, too. He just doesn't get credit,
no.
I don't think, for how essential he is as a star of the 50s.
And also, standing out for me in this viewing was the writing and the performance of the little kid as the comic relief.
Hey you, Tarzan!
She's absolutely fantastic. Who is this actress? Let's give her a shout out.
Yeah, well, she's reading about Huck Finn to Jane Wyman, and she's kind of like a Huck Finn herself.
Yeah, she's like a gender non-conforming little girl.
Yeah.
They always say that a girl's in real trouble when she doesn't have a figure or muscles. Hold on. Played by Judy Nugent. Her oldest sister, Carol Nugent, also became an actress. That sounds familiar.
Oh, that's too bad. She died in 2023.
I guess we're also going to see her in There's Always Tomorrow. Yeah, she must be one of Fred McMurray's kids.
So we do have a couple more Sirks on the program that we'll be discussing in Fear and Moviegoing episodes very soon. And I guess that will be it for this week. Next time on the program, it'll be Universal 1945. We'll be discussing The Suspect and Lady on a Train. Looking forward to those.